Hello, my dear, dear friends. Welcome to the Lharbur Show. I am your host, Luke Harbur. Today I have the incredible Evan. He is my friend, as well as an amazing visual artist. Evan, how are you doing today, my friend?
So good, brother. Thank you for having me on the show.
Hell
really
yeah.
Appreciate it.
Oh, hell yeah, dude. Yeah. Are you freaking ready?
I'm ready.
To do this.
I'm so ready.
Amazing. So up first, we have our first segment, which is Harbur Hot Takes. Evan is going to get three random topics and only have one sentence to share. Per topic.
Only one sentence.
Only one.
Okay. I'll try to be a man of few words.
Amazing. So here we go.
Okay.
The first topic. What is your thought on weed?
Weed? Weed is life.
All right. Very good. Very cool, man. Okay. Number two. What are your thoughts in one sentence on alcohol?
Alcohol.
No, you're good.
One sentence on alcohol. Alcohol is also life. I feel like both.
That's fine. There we go. So weed is life. Alcohol is life. That's great. And number three, probably the hardest one out of the three. What are your thoughts on mayonnaise ice cream?
Incredibly strange, but oddly enough, I really want to try it.
That's perfect, man. Yeah. That's great. And now we have our second segment of the show, which is Harbur Talk. Mr. Evan here is going to get 9 minutes, and we're going to talk about three taboo topics, and it can be as long or as short as you want to about those topics within that 9 minutes. Right. Sound good, man?
Yeah.
Okay. Wonderful. Sweet. In that case, let me pull up the timer, and we will start in 3, 2, 1. So, Evan, the first thing that I really want to talk to you today was submitted by somebody, and it's the taboo topic of quitting your job.
Yeah.
So why do you think that's a taboo topic? Why do you think someone would submit that?
Because I think it's a very risky thing to do, especially if you don't have like a plan,
right?
which is kind of my story.
Yeah.
Not only is like your whole life dependent upon your job, but I think that so many people feel trapped at their job and they want to get free of it.
Right.
You know, they want to kind of move on to what they really want to be doing with their life. It's so hard to find the balance of, you know, having the right amount of free time, yes, money, and energy in your life, I feel
right.
And so I'm trying to find the balance between all three, because I don't want to work too much, you know, because I have money,
sure,
and I don't have time.
Sure.
But with my last, like, big job, I was working for a company called EWI, and I was traveling every week, working ridiculous hours, you know.
Right.
We'd work from, like, 6 in the morning to, like, 8 p.m. a lot of days, Monday through Friday. We come home on the weekends. But I would, you know, I just worked myself to death, and
yeah.
I honestly wasn't really a huge fan of the people I was working with.
Right.
And so I decided to relieve myself from this job because I got into like a lot of drug use and all these different bad things kind of were happening in my life. And I saw this job as the root of it. So I just flat out quit with a couple. I mean, I had like 5,000 in my account.
That's good.
So I didn't really have a plan, but I knew that I did not want to spend the rest of my life just working away every minute of it. So I quit my job, and then I spent like the next 3 or 4 months just painting, just kind of delving into what I really wanted to be doing.
Yeah.
And then after that is kind of when I started formulating a plan and like kind of made a career out of you know, what I do with murals,
that's
commission pieces.
So for you, quitting your job gave you the personal clarity of really pursuing your passion of doing what you do today.
Definitely.
And I'm sure, not that you, I mean, you did work your freaking ass off to get to where you are. I know that.
Definitely.
So in that sense, you know, why do you think, you know, I think some people don't quit their jobs because they feel like they have to be a provider, especially if they're a part of a family, you know, it's hard.
Definitely. 100%.
And I guess it's easier when you're younger to make that kind of decision.
This is the time when I'm like most dangerous, I feel like, right? Because I have no responsibilities, right? No kids, no dog. I do have a lady, but she takes care of herself. I take care of myself. It is more to do with like, this is my time. Because if I don't go after it now, then I'm definitely not going to go after it when I'm 30 or 40. Because, you know, by then I will really want, you know, a career that's, like, firm and I can just relax and,
well,
and
sure.
work for the rest of my life. But
that's good.
Yeah, now it was definitely the time. And I'm 24 and I'm still fairly young, you know.
Yeah.
And I feel like where I'm at is, or at least what other people are telling me, where I'm at is pretty great as far as, like, talent and
good.
And everything. It, for how young I am, I feel very successful.
Well, I'm proud of you for that. That's amazing, man. Now, that actually was a perfect segue into the next topic, which is people paying for visual art. I think, for me, it's something that's worth talking about that's kind of taboo, because some people really want to take advantage of people's skills in visual art. Or there are the people who literally use the visual art as their own status symbol. I've seen that.
Definitely.
You know, where they're
definitely.
Like, I own this 100%. Person's art, so I have status.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on that?
So on kind of both ends of the spectrum, I've, like, you know, I've done a mural piece that I got commissioned to do, and I got paid like half up front, and I ended up getting hurt on the job,
uh-huh.
which is awful.
Uh-huh.
And I wasn't able to, actually, I went back to the job like a couple days later, still hurt, finished the project, and lady didn't even pay me for what I did. Like, it was like for her personal business, whatever, but like
she
was not about it. So I had to learn from that situation a lot. Like, I was more obviously from a business side, but just I've had to protect myself with certain things.
Yeah.
But like on the other side, it's like I did like a plaza fountain painting, right?
Right.
For this couple, and it was like they had a beautiful home. Like they invited me in their home.
That's
it was
amazing.
Huge. It
so
was,
it really complimented everything
100%.
That they were doing.
Yeah. It was. I'm just so fortunate. I feel like to have those opportunities as well.
Because yeah.
I feel like there's so many people that like aren't able to sell paintings like that. And it was a 6 foot by 4 foot. Painting, and it was, you know, it's a stretch canvas. I stretched it myself, like from ground up. I built it, and I felt really connected to the piece, and
yeah.
it was such a rewarding feeling just to be able to deliver it to their house and be able to put it up on the wall. It was really big, and I love that that they're wanting to invest in someone that's alive as
Isn't
well.
That
like
really
just,
nice
it's just
when people
being
are
able
not
to
just
help
like,
me out.
Yeah.
yeah.
They're not
sure.
in pursuit of the collection, but they're in pursuit of the actual passion
yeah.
and the practice
exactly.
alive today.
And I love the fact that like they didn't just like see a painting and they loved it. They saw my and wanted to purchase that painting. They saw my work and they wanted to commission something personally for them. Is what I really liked about the situation.
Yeah, that's phenomenal.
Yeah.
That's the way it should
yeah.
be, man.
I feel like it really should be that way, because it makes it more personable, not just some painting that I made in my studio. Well, I mean, either way, depends on what your connection is to the piece.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good. The last segment for today is something that you wanted to talk about and you know, are open to talking about is identifying as biracial, being
yes.
biracial.
Yeah.
Now, why do you think that's taboo? I mean, we had an amazing conversation about it a little earlier, but why? Why do you think that's taboo?
Well, I think mainly for me, like, I haven't heard a whole lot of conversation about being biracial, and it might just be because I'm not paying a whole lot of attention.
Sure.
Because I could be pretty selfish in that, I think. I don't do a whole lot of social media or really news or anything for that matter. I more just focus on my craft and try to get better. So I guess I'll just kind of start talking about it.
Sure, man.
Like growing up, it was always kind of difficult for me.
Right.
Because, you know, my mother's white, my father's black.
Mm-hmm.
And they named me Evan, which I would assume that was, you know, more like a Caucasian name.
Sure.
At least if I saw a person named Evan Daniel Jackson, I wouldn't assume they're a black covered in tattoos.
Sure, sure.
But that's also just an assumption.
Well, sure.
So I just felt like my parents kind of like sheltered me throughout my youth. I felt like I was only introduced mainly to like white suburbia,
mm-hmm.
and so like most of my friends were white, and,
right.
and so growing up, it was hard because you know I wasn't like them. Like I remember like
right.
When I was in like the third grade, my mother was trying to kind of spike up the front of my hair, just
yeah.
like all the other kids in my class, and
right, right,
and it just didn't work because my hair is different, and so
sure.
Growing up, I had to figure out like, okay, so you are black, but you're also white, so. Kind of, you know, going through those years of growing up, like, you know, 1 year I'd be the skater kid, and the next, you know, I'm the OG wearing the really oversized white tee.
Sure, right.
But I think that I didn't really figure out truly who I was until after I moved out of my house. I started working at UPS in the mornings, and I was working predominantly around Black people.
Yeah.
And so just going through that, like a lot of them kind of viewed me, you know, as a white male. And, you know, throughout my life, white males usually viewed me as Black. So it's kind of interesting seeing on either end how you're treated, I feel like. But I didn't really feel like, you know, I was Evan until maybe I was like 18, 19. I just kind of came to this conclusion that, like, this is me. This is my life. And nothing nothing's going to change that. So I just need to stay true. You know, to myself, and just go after the things that I really want in my life, because I'm only living my life for me. In the end.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, you know, when you're young, you want that sense of validation that what you're doing is okay behavior, that you're blending in, that you have your own identity as a whole. I think as we get older, at least in my experience, you can get validation that it's great to be who you are and what you do through your own medium. Like, I mean, even for me, sometimes it can come through fashion. You know, like, I love, like, definitely. Dude, sometimes, I mean, it's obviously a much different case scenario, but when it comes to just having power and pride in your identity, sometimes I want to wear a suit. Yes. Literally, sometimes, man, I want to wear freaking sweatpants and my shoes and a shirt, exactly. You know, and just be chill and calm.
And so much confidence stems from that, too, when, like, you truly feel like yourself, like, nothing can stop you.
Nothing
you
can
just
stop
you. Have that walk, and people can see that.
Oh, shoot. Yeah. We all got that walk.
Exactly. We all got that walk.
Hey, man. That's it. That was it. Hey, great freaking job,
thank you.
Dude.
That was wonderful.
That was so good.
I got muscle like Superman.
Real. Oh, he's like, he's getting jacked.